Hello and welcome to Apportion Ministries. Paulette Denise here. I woke up this morning and Holy Spirit was showing me pride needs to come down. He said, and I'm praying for someone as an intercessor. So every time you hear something, it's not necessarily that it's directly for you. As an intercessor, you're called to stand in the gap on behalf of others that sometimes don't even know that they need this type of standing. And so I knew exactly where God was sending me with this message. If you have this book, it's Renewal of the Mind According to Romans 12:2. This is a book that Holy Spirit allowed me to write in 2014. Powerful book. It is available on Amazon. Put in Paulette Denise Renewal of the Mind, or you can contact me, paulettex7@gmail.com, especially if you're in the Houston area. And so we're going to be in chapter 4, Kingdom Mindsets. And at the beginning of this mindsets chapter, Holy Spirit had me open this chapter looking at pride. And so we're just going to walk through it. I'm the writer, so I can expound even the more, being that it was published in 14, and here we are. Today is June 6, 2019, and we're just going to delve in and see what Holy Spirit wants to say to us. Holy Spirit, we give you access to come into this time of Bible study and time of iron sharpens iron. We thank you for being our teacher, that you are the revealer of truth, that you are Holy Spirit. You are the keeper and the maintainer of truth. And so we come right now and we give you access, oh God, to search our hearts and see if there be any way in us that's not like you, any prideful way in us, and lead us in your way everlasting. Let us fall out of agreement with the lies that would have us in an appearance of pride. But we want to be the opposite of pride, is to be humble in your presence. I only want godly pride in you, oh God, but I prefer to be humble in your sight. And so we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. As I said, you would want to get the book because I'm going to skip around in this chapter. But I open it up saying that wheat grows with the weed. The wheat will humble themselves as they mature. So you may have had some prideful ways, and that's why I always tell people, be careful judging someone on the way they were a year ago, 4 years ago, because as you mature, you will humble yourself. So maybe in the beginning, there was a zeal without knowledge that appeared like pride. And Jesus said, wait, let them both grow together, because if you try and pull out the weeds right now, you might damage some of the wheat. Just let it grow together. And that's when God gave me the principle that the wheat will humble themselves as they mature, and the false will be lifted up in pride and will not bow down, but will be cut down. It's all about humility versus pride. And so this person that I'm interceding for, I pray scriptures of humility, that they would humble themselves in the presence of the Lord, humble themselves under the hand of the Almighty, that they would humble themselves so that when they do resist the enemy has no choice but to flee. But if we have any area of unchecked pride in our heart, when the enemy comes at us and we try to resist him to the degree that you're not submitted and humbled unto God, the enemy will appear to be winning. But his mission is to kill, steal, and destroy. You serve the one whose mission is to be an abundant life giver. So I'm just sounding the alarm. You know, I'm a watchman on the wall. I'm prophetically sounding the alarm in the Word of God to get our attention. Romans 12 verse 2 reads, for by the grace, the unmerited favor of God given to me, I warn everyone among you not to estimate and think of himself more highly than he ought, not to have an exaggerated opinion of his own importance, but to rate his ability with sober judgment, each according to the degree of faith apportioned by God to himself. So I said verse 3 is all about humility versus pride. We must remain humble before the Lord. Allow him to correct us and instruct us. Some people are even prideful with the fact that they've renewed their mind. They have an attitude as if it were them, when really it was done with the help of Holy Spirit, as we heard about the need. Our assignment is to help others do the same, not to lord it over them that you don't think like that anymore. As a matter of fact, when we see people thinking like we used to think, we ought to do like in the book of Jude. This is Jude chapter 1, verse 20 through 22. It says, but you, beloved, build yourselves up, founded on your most holy faith. Make progress. Rise like an edifice, higher and higher, praying in the Holy Spirit. Guard and keep yourselves in the love of God. I did a recording yesterday about the significance of the love of God, that everything that we do must be done in love, and we must be permeated in love to be able to resist the enemy. But anyway, so this scripture is saying guard and keep yourselves, and that's what he was saying. This was in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 at verse 14 and verse 24. It's talking about love and guarding as well. But anyway, it says, expect and patiently wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, which will bring you unto life eternal, and refute so as to convict some who dispute with you, and on some have mercy who waver in doubt. I went on to say, have mercy. Some will waver in doubt. Don't judge them. You don't have a hell to put them in, and you can't get them in heaven. You need to have mercy on them. Verse 23 goes on to show us how to have and show this mercy. Jude 1:23 says, strive to save others, snatching them out of the fire. On others take pity, but with fear, loathing even the garment spotted by the flesh and polluted by their sensuality. And this is our role in what we should be doing with the believers. And when God sounds the alarm, you know, as an immature intercessor, when God said pride, number one, I'm checking myself, but you do check yourself and make sure that you don't have no pride in you, because how can you cast out what you're sleeping with? So that's number one. But then number two, instead of, oh, they lifted up in pride, and instead of having an attitude, it breaks my heart to know that the deceitfulness of pride is coming in and robbing you from your destiny of where God, that's it. A destiny robber is pride, demonic pride, and it will cloak itself in a religious spirit. It will cloak itself in performance orientation. You're prideful in what you've done instead of unto the Lord. Let me not go on that rabbit trail. The way that I wrote this book is I would do some teaching and then I would insert a prayer. And so here is a prayer about what we just said and what we're about to say. Thank you for causing your people to really think about what we're thinking about. That you are causing us to powerfully and effectively change and renew our mind according to your word. Thank you that we are dual citizens and you are helping us to see what it means to be a simultaneous citizen of the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of earth. Thank you, God, that you are increasing our understanding and knowledge. Increase us by giving us revelation, illumination, knowledge, insight, wisdom into your kingdom, into the way of doing and being right, and to righteousness, into all that you would have us to see. As we go forward into this section, allow us to get a healthy understanding of the word pride in our minds and know how to operate with it, to eradicate worldly thinking about pridefulness and replace it with your mindset of what true pride is. Our pride, our trust, our hope, our confidence are all in you, not in self or in our own abilities or in the arm of man, but in you. Amen. And so I went on to talk about how before we can properly talk about pride, we have to talk about where it entered. And so I went into Genesis chapter 3, how pride came in and deceitfully with deception. And then I went to the Genesis, a cinematic moment, as I called it, in Ezekiel 28, verse 13 through 19, and then again in Isaiah 14, verse 11 through 17, where you're seeing the adversary, the worshiping angel being evicted out of heaven because iniquity was in his heart. And he's fallen. They said, oh, how have you fallen from heaven, O light bringer? So this was exposing the roots. I'm not going to read all of that. You can read it in context in your own Bible. Again, that's Ezekiel 28, verse 13 through 19, and Isaiah 14, verse 11 through 17. If you have the book, you can read it. It's on page 177 and 170, I'm sorry, 178 and 79. So after I quote and I put those in here, them big chunks of scripture, because you got to understand the roots. We're dealing with roots. One of the mandates of this project is Jeremiah 1:10, that we're going to uproot some things, demolish some things, tear down some things, but then we're going to plant the righteousness, the right kind of pride. And so I said, we're exposing the root of pride. Now bringing this back to Romans 12, renewal of the mind and the pride piece, we have to make sure that we eradicate worldly pride from our vocabulary. It must be uprooted. We can't deal with pride from a worldly viewpoint. And then I went to Job 33, verse 15 through 17. This is a good scripture, and understand, especially because some of us are hard-headed, and even though the watchman is sounding the alarm, we're not going to listen. But Job 33:15 says, one may hear God's voice in a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falls on men while slumbering upon the bed. Then he opens the ears of men and seals their instruction, terrifying them with warnings, that he may withdraw man from his purpose and cut off pride from him, disgusting him with his own disappointing self-sufficiency. I like that definition where the Amplified calls pride, says of pride what God is going to do. Sometimes we won't listen, so he waits until we go to sleep. The natural body is sleep. Spirit man is always awake. And so God says, this is when I can come and get you and discuss you with your own disappointing self-sufficiency. So if you have pride in your self-sufficiency, it's all wrong. And so God will get our attention. What I had written in the book here was, from this Job 33 reference, I see that God reveals his will, yet we don't listen half the time. So he does, as with verse 15, he approaches in a dream and a vision to open the ears of men. This explains God waking us up at the 3 a.m. times. He's trying to get us to see, as in verse 17, to cut off pride, as the Amplified says, to disgust us with our own disappointing self-sufficiency. There should be no pride in self, in me, in man, but only in God. Check yourself. I'm just going to say that. Check yourself. Proverbs 11:2 says, when swelling and pride come, then emptiness and shame come also. But with the humble, those who are lowly, who have been pruned or chiseled by trial and renounce self. So how do I get rid of pride and how do I get humble? You're going to be pruned. You're going to be chiseled. That's some cutting with a two-edged sword of the word. How? By trial. And then what's gonna be the result of that? Not that you murmur and complain with God, why I had to go through all of this. No, you will renounce self. I know it couldn't be me, no way. It had to be you and me. So you renounce self and skillful godly wisdom and soundness. I said no swelling, as in the reference of Romans 12:3. Don't get the big head. The opposite of pride is humility. And we can see here that my pride is in him, which makes me lowly because I've been pruned and chiseled, so I now renounce self. I have learned how to be selfless in his righteousness. Come on, we need to get that down. Learn how to be selfless. See selfless in his righteousness, the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ. It is as we truly grasp the principle of humility, not having worldly pride, that the wisdom and soundness operate in our lives. Two more Proverbs. Proverbs 21:24, the proud and haughty man, scoffer is his name, deals and acts with overbearing pride. And then Proverbs 29:23, a man's pride will bring him low, but he who is of a humble spirit will obtain honor. Our pride is in God, and that will make us humble. Either way it goes, you're going to get low. Either you will humble yourselves, that's prostrate ourselves in the presence of God, get low. Or we'll get lifted up in pride and get knocked down, get low. I would rather just humble myself and not get knocked down. Matthew 23:12 says, whoever exalts himself with haughtiness and empty pride shall be humbled or brought low. And whoever humbles himself, whoever has a modest opinion of himself and behaves accordingly, shall be raised to honor. So we see what Jesus wants us to do. I made reference to it. I'm not going to read all of the scripture. James chapter 4, verse 6 through 8, where it's saying that he gives more grace upon grace, power of the Holy Spirit, to meet this evil tendency in all other duties. So God sets himself against the proud and the haughty, but he gives grace continually to the lowly, those who are humble enough to receive it. So subject yourselves to God. Do you understand that if you don't have a good understanding of humility and eradicating worldly pride, you won't be able to submit to God? And that next verse says, resist the devil and he'll flee. Verse 8 says, come close to God and he'll come close to you. Keep reading it. God is speaking. I wrote, we must do verse 6 thoroughly to be able to do verse 7. So verse 6 was about humbling ourselves. You must thoroughly know how to humble yourself so that you can be submitted unto God. And we must not operate proud or haughty or have pride in anything else but God. The devil has fooled many people to think that their pride is in God when really it's not. Since we're not humble before God, we're resisting the devil, but he's not fleeing, but riding our back. It is as we are thoroughly humbled and submitted to God that we can resist the devil. Even as that last verse says, when we're being chiseled, that verse that said that he's chiseling me, pruning me, chiseling me by trial. Mm-hmm. Stop trying to get out of it. Go ahead and get low. Okay. It says resist the devil, not talk to him or rebuke him or cast him out, but resist him through the grace and power gained through being submitted unto God. I just gave you a secret right there. Stop hollering at the devil. Submit yourself unto God and God will take care of him. This is another component in the renewal of the mind process of how to defeat the works of the enemy in our lives. I found a definition of pride in Mark 7:22 that says, pride is the sin of an uplifted heart against God and man. When I read that this morning, that pride is the sin of an uplifted heart against God and man, I wrote evidenced by judgmental thoughts, comments, and behavior toward men, and we saying in the name of the Lord. Check ourselves. If the shoe fits, walk it out and get humble. And so, let me skip because I'm running out of time. At the bottom of the page, Philippians 3:3. For we Christians are the true circumcision who worship God in spirit and by the Spirit of God and exalt in glory and pride ourselves in Jesus Christ and put no confidence or dependence on what we are in the flesh and on outward privileges and physical advantages and external appearances. And so I said, no confidence or pride in the flesh, but in Jesus Christ, not in church, not in religion, tradition, regulations, not in following rules, coming every Sunday and every Wednesday, but our pride is in Jesus Christ. This Philippians 3:3 is good, healthy, godly pride. This is also a part of why I minister as Paulette Denise with no last name, because the Lord told me that flesh and blood had nothing to do with the anointing that is in my life. It is all for his glory. Another definition of pride is found here in this section on the qualification of leaders. I'm going to skip that section, but you can read it in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. And then I quote a big, huge chunk of scripture, 1 Peter 5, verse 5 through 10. Read it all on your own. It's got some good information and showing you how to eradicate pride. Again, the opposite of pride is humility. So we should check ourselves daily to make sure that we are operating in humility. Also, this text is similar to the earlier text in James and shows the connection between being humble to God under his hand to be exalted in his due season. But even more than the exaltation part, being humble will equip us to be able to live worry-free because we are able to cast all of our cares, concerns, worries, and anxieties on God with confidence, with godly pride that he cares for us and is able to take care of them all and empower us even further with the ability to be sober of mind because our pride is in him. We've dropped off the things that try to coax us into worldly pride. Therefore, we see the plan of the enemy in verse 8 being like a lion. He's not a lion, but like a lion, that we are able to withstand because we're firm in the faith in Jesus Christ. Our pride is in him, so we defeat the enemy at his tricks, schemes, wiles, plans, strategies, because we have the godly strategy of humility. 1 John 2:16 shows us that all that's in the world is the lust of the flesh, which is craving for sensual gratification, and the lust of the eyes, which is greedy longings of the mind, and the pride of life, which is assurance in one's own resources or in the stability of earthly things. These don't come from the Father, but they're from the world itself. We renew our mind to not think like the world as identified here in this text. The pride of life puts our confidence in stuff or in self, which can be here today and gone tomorrow. And so I want to close out this recording. I got 1 minute left, so the time will run out on me. There's a huge prayer on page 183. We're just going to read both of them. It says, thank you for causing us to be a people that do not operate in the pride of this world, but to be a pride-less people. We hold no pride in self, no pride in the flesh, the arm of man, but our hope, our trust, our confidence, our assurance is in you. We better understand the pride that comes from being in Jesus Christ, that it has nothing to do with the earthly realm. Thank you for Apportion Ministries that you have called for such a time as this. We will rise up and seek you and hear from you. Then you allow us to chronicle what it is that you're saying. Thank you for feeding your people and for loving your people so much, and for those you have hidden in places, but they are yet studying, meditating, eating, and metabolizing your word. Thank you for the remnant that is yet seeking after you and studying for you to get the glory. I'm running out.